Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. One of the questions I get asked most often is, who do you like better, NASA or SpaceX? Who do I like better? What? Is that even a fair question? That's almost like saying, who do you like better, the Chicago Bulls or the NBA? Or perhaps Manchester United or FIFA? Well, it's not quite that simple, but hold on. In this day and age of extreme SpaceX fandom, of which I'm 100% not guilty of, you get a Falcon 9, you get a Falcon Heavy. Falcon Heavy.
Hey, SpaceX!
It's important we reflect on the relationship SpaceX has with NASA, how they collaborate, how they differ, and why NASA's future role in space exploration is as important now as ever. And although I don't think it's fair to compare a government agency to a private company in general, there is one thing we'll be comparing in my next video, and that's their rockets. Okay, so NASA versus SpaceX, fight! Or hug. I don't know which one yet, so let's get started.
3, 2, 1.
On July 29th, 1958, President Dwight D. Eisenhower signed the National Aeronautics and Space Act into law. The National Advisory Committee on Aeronautics would become a new government agency called NASA, and the Department of Defense would transfer non-military space assets to them. This set a tone for the friendly and peaceful exploration of space. But despite its peaceful conception, it was formed primarily as a response to the threat of the hostile Soviet Union having put something into orbit before the United States did. In just over a decade, NASA went from a fledgling little aerospace entity into a well-oiled and well-funded machine, capable of putting humans on the surface of the moon. NASA went from launching people on top of small intercontinental ballistic missiles with Freedom 7 in 1961 to launching astronauts on top of a 111-meter or 363-foot tall flying skyscraper with enough explosive energy to match a small nuclear warhead. They did so in less than 8 years when they flew astronauts on top of the first Saturn V rocket for the Apollo 8 mission in 1968. The advancements that took place during the Apollo era are legendary and advanced our collective knowledge as a species as a whole, ushering a new era of understanding and scientific discovery. Not to mention inspiring a new generation of engineers, mathematicians, and scientists, which definitely helped spark the United States' leap forward in creating high-tech industry and a booming tech economy. So not only did NASA learn how to put humans in space and then soon after put them on another planetary body, they've also taught us how to live in space, first with Skylab, and then the space shuttles and space lab, and then they even helped build the International Space Station. You know, that football field-sized flying laboratory that orbits the Earth 10 times faster than a bullet, which you yourself can wave to under the right conditions. Yeah, that thing. Okay, not only that, but let's not forget about the Pioneer missions, which were the first spacecraft to visit Jupiter and Saturn, or Voyager 1 and 2, the first probes to do a grand tour of our solar system, or how about the 4 wildly successful Mars rovers and 3 Mars landers, or Cassini-Huygens, which explored Saturn, or what about the Hubble Space Telescope? Okay, this list goes on and on and on, and the knowledge gained from NASA has been game-changing, to say the least. Despite all of NASA's wildly successful missions, people are seemingly critical of NASA these days, citing over-budget missions and rockets, red tape everywhere, and sort of having to be told what to do by people who know very little about space. Congress. And compared to NASA, SpaceX is just the new kid on the block. Having been founded in 2002 by Elon Musk, SpaceX went from almost certain failure down to literally their last pennies and just one last attempt at reaching orbit with their Falcon 1 rocket to being the most popular launch provider, now offering one of the cheapest rides to space on one of the most advanced self-landing and partially reusable rocket, the Falcon 9. SpaceX is a private company who sells rides to space. A customer, say NASA, SES, Iridium, TICOM, the Air Force, or anyone else wanting to put something in space, can hire SpaceX and one of their rockets to get the job done. SpaceX has become the new goalpost, which people measure other space companies and agencies against. With their very public displays of trial and error, never-ending ambition, and superstar CEO Elon Musk, they've inspired a new generation of space dreamers, picking up where NASA left off after the cancellation of the space shuttle program. So let's actually start there. I think this moment in time, when the commercial program was just starting and the space shuttle program was just ending, is the most important moment in time that can help us understand the current and future relationship of NASA and SpaceX. Despite wanting to develop commercial options as far back as 1984, NASA finally announced a program called Commercial Orbital Transportation Services, or COTS, in January of 2006. NASA started accepting proposals from companies 2 months later. The companies had to show off their concept for delivery of cargo and eventually crew to the International Space Station. And here's where the relationship with NASA and SpaceX began. In August of 2006, SpaceX secured a contract with NASA to develop their proposed vehicles. NASA's initial investment to SpaceX was $278 million to develop their Falcon 9 and Dragon spacecraft. Did you hear that? NASA paid for SpaceX to develop the Falcon 9. So right there, I hope we begin to understand the relationship between SpaceX and NASA. This is starting to sound a lot more like hugs and not boxing gloves, but let's keep going. Before SpaceX even launched their first Falcon 9 and Dragon capsule, SpaceX secured a contract for Commercial Resupply Services, or CRS, from NASA. Now here's where the big investment comes in. NASA invested $1.6 billion in SpaceX, ensuring SpaceX would have what it takes to get the Falcon 9 going. So before SpaceX had even flown their workhorse Falcon 9 once, NASA had promised nearly $2 billion in the company. It's pretty obvious here that NASA hasn't seen SpaceX as a competitor. Instead, they have always intended to give SpaceX funding to take over and provide services for NASA so they could pursue bigger rockets and spend more on scientific and experimental endeavors. You know, keep exploring space. I think this is a detail that's often overlooked or forgotten. NASA is SpaceX's biggest customer and supporter. SpaceX would arguably be nothing if it weren't for NASA, not only with NASA's funding, but also by tapping into NASA's knowledge base, their legacy of public information, and leaning on their expertise in certifying their vehicles. Not to mention, SpaceX goes to NASA when they experience a problem, and NASA helps them out. Don't forget, Elon has mentioned many times how much he loves NASA, and I think his previous password on his computer is pretty telling of that fact.
You know, for a long time, my password was, "I love NASA." That is actually true.
Another thing to remember is SpaceX leases Pad 39A from NASA. You know, the hollowed ground where humans left Earth to walk on the moon and where most space shuttles took off from. So obviously, they have a pretty good working relationship. So with NASA being famous for basically inventing how to space, let's take a look at how NASA traditionally designs, builds, and pays for spacecraft compared to how SpaceX does. NASA has traditionally hired out work with contractors on what's known as cost-plus contracting. The idea here is you hire someone to build, say, a command module, you then pay them to do that, and then they tack on a little extra for their profit. Cost-plus contracting goes way back to World War II, when urgency was the most critical factor in getting the product in place. The cost efficiency goes way down on the list when it comes to war. Getting someone to work on the project immediately really matters at times of war in order to get the product done as quickly as possible. There's a few big issues with this way of handling contracts. Number one, there's little to no incentive for the contractor to complete a project on budget or on time. If it just costs this much to do something, and then they still make a profit on top of that, it's just a win-win for the contractor. Second, if the customer, in this case the government, changes its mind or direction, like it tends to do with every administration change, the contractor might get paid multiple times to do the same work over and over as the program changes. That habit stuck around when it came to NASA's development and how it handled the hiring of contractors, especially since the space race was essentially a peaceful show of arms that was really rooted in military supremacy. Getting things done quickly really mattered more than the cost. But cost-plus contracting still makes sense when dealing with, say, a one-off Martian rover like the Curiosity Mars rover or something like that. There isn't room to have a contractor fail, so it just makes sense to say, hey, build this one thing and we'll pay you for it. That being said, the government and the space industry got pretty hooked on this cost-plus contracting thing being the norm. It's taken up until fairly recently to figure out a better way to handle these contracts. And now we get into fixed price contracting. Fixed price contracting is the concept of basically stating how much you're willing to spend for a project, and then contractors can bid and try to win the contract. This helps offset the risk for the customer and makes the contractor have more skin in the game. The problem is, if the project is too ambitious, there's a chance the project will just simply fail. A company could spend the money and fall short, and the project would be a big flop. Historically speaking, fixed-price contracting hasn't always gone very well for the military, featuring a few programs that cost billions of dollars that wound up being canceled due to the contractor simply unable to deliver. So when it comes to NASA hiring SpaceX under the CRS contracts, it's a new approach that paid off big time for NASA and SpaceX. Okay, moving on, one of the most interesting aspects of NASA is the fact that its facilities are spread throughout the entire United States. Have you ever noticed that astronauts always call back to Mission Control in Houston, Texas, even though they launch from Cape Canaveral in Florida? Well, there are NASA centers in 8 states and many other facilities in even more states. This can be a little confusing, but there's a good reason for that. Since NASA is government funded and the budget for NASA projects are derived by Congress, as NASA and its workforce grew leading up to the Apollo era, it needed support from as many members of Congress as possible. For instance, by placing a major center in Houston, NASA would gain support from the Texas members of the House and Senate, which represents over 8% of Congress. So, by spreading their centers throughout the United States, NASA almost automatically has members of Congress on their team who will want jobs in their state and to keep NASA well-funded. Of course, there are some inefficiencies when having to deal with your workforce being spread throughout the entire country, especially when it comes to building and testing huge rockets. Parts of the Saturn V rocket were manufactured and tested across the entire United States, which is an unusual way to test and build something, but it worked. Between NASA and its contractors, there were nearly 400,000 people who worked on the Apollo program. But once we landed on the moon, the public almost immediately lost interest. And this is why, despite taking around 200,000 years of human existence to get humans to the moon, we only explored for about exactly 4 years, and then we stopped going altogether and have yet to return. What a shame. This led to thousands of well-trained, highly educated, and intelligent people now twiddling their thumbs. Or as a NASA headquarters official described the Marshall Flight Center post-Apollo, a tremendous solution looking for a problem. With its budget shrinking, NASA was left to shift its focus from the moon and Mars to a low Earth orbit infrastructure by developing the Space Transportation System, better known as the Space Shuttle. The Space Shuttle was designed to bring the cost of spaceflight down by reusing the majority of the vehicle. But the Space Shuttle's design was compromised from the get-go by kind of being designed by committee. Everyone had a say in what they wanted the Space Shuttle to be and do. This led to the military getting a cargo bay large enough to launch large spy satellites, Congress not wanting to spend more money to make the vehicle more reusable, and many other design compromises that ultimately left humanity stuck in low Earth orbit ever since. Now, when it comes time to actually designing and building rockets, SpaceX does things differently than traditional aerospace companies. And this is where some people might be confused. SpaceX has changed the game for the aerospace industry by developing and manufacturing most things in-house. They build their own engines, their own flight computers, and even their own spacecraft, all under one roof. This is really unusual. The fact that the engineers who design the rockets have an office in the same building as where the rockets are being manufactured means there's a tight relationship between the designing and the building of the rockets. This is another thing that SpaceX does that's unusual. They are constantly tweaking their rockets, to the point where, according to SpaceX's VP of production, Andy Lambert, SpaceX has never built any two vehicles identically. Such is the pace of innovation at SpaceX. According to lead materials engineer Katie Dwyer, she says she can implement design changes in a week, rather than having to wait months to even have someone come take a look at that change proposal. But the fact that they are constantly tweaking and innovating their rockets is unusual. It leads to breakneck evolution of their vehicles, but also has the downsides of more potential risk. Both failures of the Falcon 9 can be indirectly attributed to SpaceX pushing the boundaries of their rockets. But in the long run, they're learning mountains and they're able to create a vehicle that's considerably more advanced, capable, and still evolving compared to other traditional aerospace companies or even say NASA. So one last thing to note is that NASA hires launch providers, say SpaceX, ULA, Orbital ATK, Rocket Lab, or whoever else comes along to launch their payloads. The Commercial Space Act started in 1998 and was a way to help develop a commercial space industry in the United States. This is how NASA puts their scientific payloads on a commercial rocket. Now, here's where you can insert your opinions on which launch provider or which rocket in particular might be best fit for a certain job. So when people say NASA versus SpaceX, maybe they should be pointing to a specific mission and say, when NASA utilized an Atlas V for their Mars InSight rover, I think they should have used a Falcon 9 for X, Y, and Z reasons. Then you can put your glasses back up on the bridge of your nose and know you at least drew the right conclusion of who versus who here. So, all things considered, I think the most important thing we need to actually solidify in our heads is what NASA's role is, and maybe more importantly, what it should be. And I think there's one word that sums it up: science. Science isn't always profitable. As a matter of fact, when it comes to understanding physics and our place in the universe, science is almost never profitable. I take that back, actually. Some estimates show that for every $1 we invest in NASA, we get $7 to $14 returned on that $1 investment due to spin-off technologies. So, I guess there's that. But in a world where NASA or other space agencies don't exist, and it's all private launch providers, who's gonna pay to send a probe out to Saturn? Then, who pays to operate that mission for a dozen years? And then, who pays to comb through all that beautiful data? Who trains astronauts to do scientific research? Who oversees operations of vehicles to make sure they're safe for people and cargo? Who will pursue the development of advanced propulsion systems that may or may not work out, like advanced ion drives, nuclear propulsion, the EM drive, or dare I say, warp drives? Who's gonna study the effects on the human anatomy in deep space? Who will study and fight the effects of deep cosmic radiation? Who will keep an eye on gene mutation after long stays in space? The universe is big. There's so much exploring to do, and I think that's what NASA's primary mission should be: to explore space and do science that's broadening our understanding of the universe, and continue to employ the greatest minds to make massive breakthroughs in propulsion, habitats, exoplanets, human health in space, and even what it takes to live on other planets. NASA and SpaceX, as well as all other private companies, will continue to work together, and they'll continue to literally broaden our horizon. It's not an us versus them thing. Space is only an us thing. As I say often, space is the one border us humans share. As soon as we get off this planet, it's no longer this neighborhood versus that neighborhood, this city versus that city, this state versus that state, or this country versus that country. No, it's humans versus the universe. Okay, now all this said and done, there's one aspect we didn't get to in this video. And that's what happens when NASA builds a rocket. So what's it look like when NASA hires a contractor to build the SLS rocket? And how's that compared to when SpaceX builds the big Falcon rocket? Well, that video is coming up next, so make sure you stay tuned to get the full picture on this quote-unquote NASA versus SpaceX thing. So now, more importantly, do you think it's even fair to ask who do you like better, NASA or SpaceX? I hope, if anything, we at least help begin to clear that up. Let me know if you have any other questions on this topic. What do you think NASA's role should be moving forward? Do you still think it's NASA versus SpaceX? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. As always, I owe a huge thanks to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other everyday astronaut content possible. I owe a super extra special thanks to those patrons in our exclusive Discord channel and our exclusive subreddit for helping me script and research. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Don't forget to check out my web store for shirts, hats, mugs, prints of rocket launches and other original artwork, and lots of other fun stuff at everydayastronaut.com/shop. And as always, all the music in my videos is original. Feel free to check it out at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Tell a friend. Thanks everybody, that does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.